Hare Krishna. I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you today. And I'll speak on the topic of ecology, spirituality, and the search for a meaningful life. Last year, I was invited to Cambridge University to give a talk on science and spirituality. While we were going there, we passed by Woolstock Alley, that is the place where Newton is said to have seen the fruit, the apple falling. That same tree, remarkably, is still there. And that place is like a pilgrimage place for scientists. So people who are scientifically minded, scientifically inspired, they go there and they contemplate on Newton's brilliance in ordinary observation and an extraordinary inference from that observation. It's interesting, if you look at the event of fruit falling, millions of people have seen fruits falling. If instead of Newton, there had been a monkey who had seen the apple fall, what would the monkey have done? Eaten the fruit and gone on his way. Most humans would also have done the same thing. But Newton asked some question. What was the question? What made this fruit fall? Now, that question, what made this fruit fall, and the answer which came from it, by which he postulated the theory of gravity, that was the engine from which science took off in the pre-modern times and ushered the modern times thereafter. However, while it is his brilliance in coming up with that answer when that question came up, we can look at something more fundamental. What made him ask this question? And he asked the question because he felt that there is an orderly universe. Newton wants to come here. He's calling me, telling me where is it. So he asked. Then that asking involves an assumption. The things in nature don't happen in a disorderly way. That if a fruit is falling to the ground, there is some order in nature which we are trying to uncover. If that assumption or that pre-understanding had not been there, then he would not have asked us. Oh, yes, apple fell down. But there is an assumption that there is an inherent order in nature. And that order is what science tries to uncover. So the key point to understand here is that science begins with faith. Sometimes people think science and religion are opposite because science deals with facts and religion deals with faith. However, science cannot progress unless there is the faith that there is an order in nature. This is the foundational faith that every scientist needs to have. And this correlates with the Bhagavad Gita 4.39. Krishna says, Shraddhavan labhate jnanam. Krishna says, who can acquire knowledge? Only those who have faith. Faith is the precondition for knowledge. Faith is not in opposition to knowledge. Faith is the foundation of knowledge. So what faith are we talking about? That there is an order in nature. And we say, what faith is required? Yeah, obviously there is order in nature. But why should there be an order at all? If we consider the atheistic rendition of how the universe came about, then the autobiography of the universe or the biography of the universe would be something like this. We just put aside all that scientific jargon, all the terminology for various theories and various kinds of particles, whatever it is, we put it aside. What it essentially boils down to is that nothing existed because of nothing. Nothing exploded because of nothing and gave rise to everything. Three sentences. Nothing existed because of nothing. Nothing exploded because of nothing. And nothing gave rise to everything. It's very logical, isn't it? Actually, if you think, we think objectively, comparing the atheistic version of the universe's history with the theistic understanding, what we will end up with is that actually, if we see the order in the universe, where did that order come from? That order needs to have some order infusing source. So, actually speaking, it requires too much faith to be an atheist. We don't see anywhere nothing giving rise to everything. Everything comes from something. So the atheistic version of the universe requires a lot of faith. Nothing existed because of nothing. Nothing exploded because of nothing. And nothing gave rise to everything. So actually the point here is that science and atheism can't go together. Sometimes people say, if you are scientific, how can you believe in God? Actually, if you are scientific, you cannot be atheistic. Why? The science itself may not prove the existence of God. Because God is spiritual. God cannot be known directly through science. But science requires a foundational faith that there is an order in nature. And the atheistic worldview has no explanation for where that order came from. Even if we have some theories, say even if we talk about arguments, say we talk about theory of evolution or the theory of Big Bang, but all these theories require something pre-existent. See, theories are essentially laws. When theories become proven, they become laws. But laws are not causes. Laws describe the correlation between cause and effect. Just yesterday there was a cricket match between India and Sri Lanka in which an Indian batsman hit a record number of sixes. So when this batsman hit a record number of sixes, if after the match there's an interview, now how did you hit so many sixes? By the laws of motion. Okay, you may say, hey, laws of motion is fine. Yes, you can say, you know, okay, the ball came at this height with this pace and the batsman hit with this force, and because the batsman hit with this force, that's why it cleared the boundary. Or the ball and the bat hit with this angle, this was the momentum that came in. It would have fallen inside the boundary, but it fell outside the boundary. So now, what laws explain is the correlation between cause and effect. Because the ball and the bat came in full contact with each other, that's why the ball was propelled with this force, and that's why it cleared the boundary. But the law is not the cause. So the laws of motion themselves do not explain the existence of a cricket bat. They don't explain the existence of a cricket ball. They don't explain the existence of a cricket field. They don't explain the existence of a cricketer. They don't explain even the action of the cricketer in hitting the ball. What they explain, so there is a, for the laws to act, there has to be, first of all, the preconditions present. There has to be some substratum on which the law will act. And that substratum, that pre-existing substance, in this case, there has to be a cricket ground, there has to be a bat, there has to be a ball. And then there has to be an agent who starts the cause, who comprises the cause. And once the cause is there, then we can say, this batsman hit the ball and it went to the fielder. That batsman hit the ball and that cleared the fence. Why the difference? You can say, you know, this was hit with greater force, or there's a greater momentum because the contact between the ball and bat was greater. And that's why it cleared the fence. So the law of motion, or in general laws of science, they cannot explain everything. When there is a cause, when there is an effect, and when there is some substance on which the cause can act and the effect can emerge, and there is a causal agent which activates the cause, then the laws of nature can explain things. So science is a very powerful body of knowledge for by which we can uncover some of the laws of nature, many of the laws of nature. But no matter how much science advances, it cannot tell us where the laws of nature came from. Why the laws of nature should be present at all? Why, for that matter, nature itself should be present at all? So, this is not criticizing science. This is specifying what science is. Science is, as I said, an extremely powerful body of knowledge. However, for that body of knowledge to operate, first of all, nature has to exist, and nature has to be functioning according to certain laws. Now, why nature exists, why it functions according to those laws, that is something science can tell us. Now, this is important for one more purpose. If we look at our own lives, we see that we all get the question sometime or the other, what is the purpose of life? When I was in New York, we passed by the place where the Twin Towers were there. And even now, that place in New York where the Twin Towers were there, that's been made like a memorial to the victims who suffered and who died at that place. So now there, actually, the fall, it was not just the building that fell. It was more what the building represented. It represented it was a visible, powerful symbol of the prosperity and the security of America. And when the building fell, it was that conception of prosperity and security that was not just challenged, but it was battered. That is among the few occasions in the history of Google that God came as the highest search engine. What is the point of it all? If life can just be finished off in one moment, like this, things which are so big, so magnificent, they can just be finished off. Why? What are we living for? What really counts in life? Another point here, taking this point forward, our topic was technology, spirituality, and the search for a meaningful life. So the first point I made is, science is also a search for meaning, a search for order. When scientists observe nature, they try to find out the order in whatever they're observing. And it's not just in science. In daily life also, we try to find order. Why did he behave like this? Why did she do like that? Why did this happen? No. Why did these twin towers fall? So we try to look for sense. It's an innate human need to try to seek meaning in life. And few things challenge our search for meaning, or even frustrate our search for meaning as much as death. And not just death, but the sudden, unexpected and massive occurrence of death. So, sometimes people ask that, okay, why do bad things happen to good people? Oh, we can turn around. And this is one of the strongest arguments which atheists use to say that a good God cannot exist. Now we can turn around the question and ask, why should bad things not happen to good people?
What do you mean?
Bad things should not happen to good people. Why not? Why not? If we assume atheism as the worldview, where in the atheistic worldview is it written that good things should happen to good people and bad things should happen to bad people? In fact, the atheistic worldview is basically materialistic. And in the materialistic worldview, matter is all that exists. So, if matter is all that exists, matter has no conception of good or bad. When a coconut falls from a tree, the coconut may fall on the ground or coconut may fall on somebody's head. The coconut doesn't know anything, it simply falls. So if laws of nature are all that exist, then there is no conception of good or bad. Is this point clear? In the materialistic worldview, there is no conception of anything as good or bad. You say, no, but I know this is good, that is bad. Okay, but on what basis? So, on what basis do we say that good things should happen to good people and bad things should happen to bad people? There is no basis for that. So, when we say why do bad things happen to good people, there is an assumption that, yeah, there is a causal connection with things and good things should happen to good people and bad things should happen to bad people. But what is the basis of this assumption? In an atheistic worldview, there is no basis for this assumption. Science, Einstein himself is considered probably the greatest scientist of the last century, and he was profoundly troubled by the implications of a scientistic worldview. Not scientific, scientistic. Science is a tool for acquiring knowledge. Scientism is an ideology. Like we have communism, nationalism, like that, scientism. Scientism is an ideology which holds that science is the sole source of all knowledge. That science can tell us everything about everything. But scientism is different from science. And there is no scientific experiment to prove scientism. What experiment can we do to say that whatever science tells us, science can tell us everything about everything? No experiment. Or no, how can you do that? And so, actually scientism itself is not scientific. Einstein himself said that we can talk about the ethical foundations of science, whether science is being used ethically or not. But we cannot talk about the scientific foundation of ethics. What is right and what is wrong? Science can't tell us that. This doesn't mean, this doesn't make science bad. I'm using very careful language over here. There is moral, there is immoral, and there is amoral. Amoral means it's unconcerned about morality. So for example, if I'm sitting here and somebody walks by carrying a heavy object and then they see my foot is here and they drop it right on my foot. Why did you do that? If they did it unknowingly, that's okay. But if they did it deliberately, why would you do that? So we could say that is wrong. There is right and there is wrong. But if there is a coconut tree over there and from that coconut falls, it's not intentional over there. So the point which I am making here is that science, because it looks for the laws of nature, it doesn't consider, concern itself with morality. Science can tell a young person who has a grandmother who has left a huge inheritance for that person, that if this young man puts arsenic in his grandmother's breakfast, he can get the inheritance in a few days. Now, whether he should put that or not, that science cannot tell. We have an innate moral sense which tells us this is not good, I should not do this. So Einstein said we can talk about the ethical foundation of science, but not the scientific foundation of ethics. So again, the point which I am making here is, in our day-to-day life also, we understand there is some order. Now, exactly what is the order? What are good things? What are bad things? What good things which lead to which good things? What bad things lead to which bad things? These are specifics. And these can be discussed separately. Just as in science, there are so many specific laws. And we are even now discovering more and more specific laws and theories and principles. But we are not talking about specifics. We are talking in terms of universals over here. In terms of universals, in science, we search for meaning. We search for order. We search for patterns. And in day-to-day life also, we search for patterns. But just as atheism can't explain why there are patterns, why there are orders in nature, similarly, atheism can't explain why there should be a moral order in the world. Why should good things happen to good people? Why should bad things not happen to good people? More fundamentally, so we talked about nature, we talked about action. Let's talk about identity. We all have an innate sense of who, that we are irreducible beings. If I ask you, do you exist? What do you mean? Obviously, I exist. You say that. If you are asking this question, we'll ask the question, does your intelligence exist? It's obvious we exist. But actually, who is the I that exists? If you see, all the cells in our body die and change. Scientists were of the notion that actually our brain cells remain the same. But even our brain cells keep changing. So now, our sense of identity, how it's not just identity, but our identity associated with memory. Okay, I was a child, I am this now, I learned this, I know this, I know this language, I know speaking, I know writing, I know cycling, I know car driving, whatever. These are things which we know. Where and how is our identity and memory stored? Where is my cell phone? So, researchers found that actually when we look at our brain cells, nothing remains constant. If nothing remains constant, say suppose now right now I want to talk with him. So if I write a message and give to him, if I give that message to him, it's okay. If I give the message to him, and then suppose after that, hypothetically, I could change every single molecule that was there on the paper on which I wrote the message. And then I change every single molecule and still I found that the message is as it is. Hey, how is that possible? If all the molecules that comprise the paper on which the message is written is removed, and if still the message remains, that would mean that the message is not written only on the paper. It's also written somewhere else, from which it is getting repeatedly imprinted on the paper, again and again and again. So similarly, if all our brain cells change, then how is it that despite the change of our brain cells, our sense of identity remains the same. Our memory remains the same. That is because we are not material. There is something more to our identity than our body and our brain. Dr. Wilder Penfield is a Nobel laureate neurosurgeon. When I was in Canada in Toronto University, I gave a talk at an auditorium that is dedicated in his memory. He is considered the greatest scientist in Canada. And he did 40 years of research on the brain. And after 40 years of study, he wrote a book called The Mystery of the Mind. And in that book, he says that the brain is like a computer, but it is programmed by something outside of itself. So I explain elaborately about his research in my book, Demystifying Reincarnation. And now, I talked about three things till now. First was nature. Second was our activity, our day-to-day activity, and the order is required in that. Third is our own identity. So last I'll talk about is our desire or our longing. We all long to live forever. Not only we long to live forever, we also long to love forever. Among the millions of movies and novels that have been written, the majority are romance. And majority of romance novels or movies, they end with H-E-A. Happily ever after. Now, if you look at happily ever after, the Bhagavad Gita in 8.15 says, Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam. It's exactly opposite. Happily ever after, Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam. Now, we all know that nobody lives forever. And yes, different people in different marital relationships may have different levels of conflict. But to be forever happy, that doesn't work. Certainly the happiness part, that may be subjective, how happy who is. But objectively, there is no forever. And yet, we all long to live forever and to love forever. Where does this longing come from? If we are simply products of matter, as atheism would have us believe, then all our desires will be circumstantial. Our desires would come from the world around us. If we are simply material creatures. But in the world around us, nothing lasts forever. Even the huge mountains. When I was in America, I was in Denver. That is among the tallest places. We had gone to a mountaintop for a retreat. Among the tallest places in the whole world. Not in terms of mountain peaks, but tallest places where people live on a regular basis. So, you know, we had a number of devotees who operated. All of us had our oxygen tanks with us. Because, not that we're carrying it constantly, but at any moment, because the atmosphere is rarefied, the oxygen may decrease. So it was there for us, for everyone. So now, if you go on top of those mountains and look down, the mountains appear so huge. But still, even those mountains are not eternal. They are also having their finite lifespan. So if nothing around us is eternal, why do we have a desire for eternal life? If a child from a tribe in Central Africa who has had no contact with the world at all, whose whole world is basically the tribal village and the forest around it. That child suddenly one day goes to his mother and says, Mommy, Mommy, I want a pizza. The first thing, what will the mother ask? Now, suppose the mother has gone out and she knows what a pizza is. She will ask the child, how did you know about a pizza? There is nothing in your circumstance by which you could have thought of ever coming to know a pizza. So there is nothing in the world around us which lives forever. then why do we have the desire to live forever? Where does this desire come from? It cannot come from our circumstance, because nothing in our circumstance lives forever. The desire has to come from our core. That core, the Bhagavad Gita says, is eternal. We are souls, the soul is eternal, the soul longs for eternal life, and the soul projects that desire for eternal life onto the body. And that's why we long for eternal life. Purushah prakriti spohi bhunkte prakriti janmunan karanam guna sangosya sad asad yoni janmasu. In 13.22, the Bhagavad Gita Krishna says, the soul becomes caught in matter because of the desire to enjoy material things. And that's how the soul goes through good and bad in this world. So the key thing for us to understand is that even our desire, we may have so many desires to fulfill, but ultimately we want to have and have forever. Where does this foundational desire come from? That comes from our spirituality. So, it is from the spiritual core that our deepest desires come, and it is at the spiritual level that our deepest desires will be fulfilled. I'll conclude with last part now. In our search for a meaningful life, so now we have many different desires, and we have many different ways in which we can fulfill desires. Suppose if we are choosing a multiple choice, we are giving an answer to a multiple choice exam. Now, is it that the answer that is the first alternative that is going to be right? Always? No. We decide which alternative is right, not based on its location, but based on its content. And we evaluate. Isn't it? Similarly, within our consciousness, many desires come. And just because the desire comes first, that does not necessarily mean it is a good desire for us, or it is our best desire. Or, say, if a teacher asks a question, and say some student answers the question very loudly, is the loudest answer the best answer? Obviously not. But you see again the content of the answer. Similarly, within us, certain desires scream very loudly. I want to eat this. I want to watch this. I want to touch this. I want to buy this. And these desires, unfortunately for us, because the desires that scream the loudest within us, we tend to fulfill them first. However, the more we keep doing what we like, the more we keep doing what we like, the more we end up disliking ourselves. What do I mean? The more we keep doing what we like, the more we end up disliking ourselves. I'll talk about 2-3 different examples. Suppose somebody they get an urge to drink and they drink. Now, sometimes anything, it's fashionable to drink, it's fashionable to smoke. But if they keep drinking whenever they feel like it, what will happen? They become alcoholics. And if they become an alcoholic, they waste their money, they waste their time, they lose their self-respect, they lose the respect of others. And when people become addicted, one of the biggest problems for them is self-loathing. Self-loathing means, I dislike myself, I hate myself. Why am I like this? Why am I so? Why can't I do what I want to do? Why do I keep doing these things? So this, if we keep doing what we like, we end up disliking ourselves. It can start from very simple level. Sometimes some people just keep eating a lot. Now, some people may are genetically, they are such that even if they eat a lot, some people eat a little and still they become very fat. Some people genetically like that. Some people, they eat, they treat their trunk like a conveyor belt. They eat a lot, but still they stay thin. The body just has strong metabolism, by which they can just digest whatever they eat. But still, however good the body's metabolism is, if somebody just keeps eating, what will happen is that eventually they will become obese, they will become terribly fat, and then they will end up disliking themselves. You know, why am I so fat? So, if we keep doing whatever we like, we'll end up disliking ourselves. So, if we want to have a meaningful life, we don't have to reject our desires, but we have to select our desires. Just as we have to select, okay, just the first option of multiple choice is not necessarily right. Just the student who speaks the loudest doesn't necessarily give the right answer. You have to evaluate based on content. Similarly, there will be many desires will come within us. And today, through technology, fulfilling our desires becomes very easy. Very easy. Because you want to watch something, the entertainment from all over the world that is available, just a few clicks. You want to buy something also, we don't have to go to a shopping mall. Stay at one place, buy it. Nowadays, even people, in the past when people had, I was in an American university, there, and America, they have declared drug addiction to be like a big, it's a national disaster in some places, they have called it. So what has happened? Earlier, when people had to peddle drugs, then they would meet behind some canteen or some secret place and sell drugs. But now with everybody being online, there is the internet and there is what is called a dark net. The dark net is that which is not traceable through Google. And people who want to buy drugs, get drugs, just go on the internet and order drugs. And home delivery, it comes. So, I met one boy, he became a devotee later. But he is young, intelligent boy. His grandmother passed away. His grandmother and his mother, they did not get along well. His grandmother was very wealthy. So his grandmother, when she died, she gave her full inheritance to her son, not to her daughter, to her grandson, to this boy. And he was just around 18. He got $1 million in inheritance. And that was a time when he was exploring drugs. He started taking drugs. And he said that actually within 6 months, he spent $1 million. Spent everything. And when he was taking those drugs, there in America, by the time people are 16, 17, 18, just they go out of their parents' homes and they stay on their own. That's what is the culture. They stay in hostel or they take their own rooms. So he said during those around 8 to 10 months, when he spent 6 to 8 months, he spent $1 million. He did not go out of his room more than 6 times. Stayed in the room, watch TV, watch internet, take drugs, get stoned. If you want food also, order the food. Everything will come to you. So here, of course, fortunately after that he met some devotees. And then just as he, in the last part of inheritance, he used to go into a rehabilitation center. And that rehabilitation center, somebody had, some devotees were coming. So that's how he became connected. He was protected by that. But the important thing is that whichever desires come up within us, it's very easy to fulfill them today. But the fulfilling of our desires will not bring fulfillment. It will bring frustration. I eat this, I watch this, I do this, I buy this. It will not bring fulfillment. To bring frustration. That's why we
need
a healthy intelligence by which we can select our desires. And how will we select? We will be able to select properly when we have a sense of the purpose and meaning of life. If I'm driving from here, say I'm going to the Juhu temple for a program, then I just go straight. If I have 1.5 hours to reach for the program, I just go straight. But if I'm just driving for fun, just go out and I say, oh, this hotel, nice, let me go and eat it. Oh, this movie, let me go and watch it. Oh, there's a bar over here, let me go and enjoy. There's a pub over here, let me go here. So if we don't have any strong purpose, then we will fall prey to whatever desires come up within us. If I have a strong purpose, then even if the desire comes, hey, this nice food over here, no, I have to go for this program, I got to go for this interview, I have to go for this exam, whatever it is. So for us, bhakti is not the process of rejecting desires. If we think, oh, I have to give up this and I have to give up that and I have to give up that, we feel, I can't give it up. No, what we have to say is, bhakti is the process of taking up. Taking up the ultimate desire. The desire for fulfilling our deepest desires. What we long for, as I said, to live forever and to love forever. So the Bhagavad Gita explains that there is an all-attractive Supreme. And we are meant to love Him. We are souls on a multi-life journey of spiritual evolution. And in this multi-life journey of spiritual evolution, the more we connect with the Eternal, the more that connection will bring satisfaction. So whatever we do in our life, it is all meant to help us connect more and more with the Eternal. So if you are studying as students, we do it in a mode of service to Krishna. We are professionals, we do our professional job in a mode of service to Krishna. When we have this purpose, whatever I am doing, my ultimate purpose is to connect with Krishna. And this knowledge we get by study of scripture, study of the Bhagavad Gita, and this understanding we get through the association of the devotees. So this, when we start living in this way, when we become spiritually purposeful, we'll find that even in this life, we will become joyful. It is not that we'll always have joy. Life will always have problems for everyone. But a basic sense of purposefulness will be there in our life. And a basic level of joyfulness will be there because we are connected with Krishna. And as the connection with Krishna becomes stronger and stronger, then the joy will also become greater and greater. And thus, the quest for a meaningful life, it cannot be fulfilled only through technology. Technology is again value neutral. It is amoral. Technology is not bad. Internet is not bad. Cell phone is not bad in itself. But if we do not have the discretion to use it properly, then whichever the loudest desires that come within us, we try to fulfill them. And then we get caught completely. But if we have the discretion to understand, not my loudest desire, but my deepest desire, and I aim to fulfill that, that understanding of what is our deepest desire will come from spirituality. And the conviction to choose our deepest desire, that will come through purification when we practice bhakti. By this, we all can, in whatever work we are doing in our life, we can have greater meaning and greater joy. And that is life's ultimate success. Because whatever we achieve, if it doesn't bring us joy, it doesn't bring us fulfillment, what is the point of it all? The point of it all is actually to find joy. Listen, I was spoke at a university in America. Its name was the American Institute of Illusion. It is actually the institute where they teach everything related to movies, how to make virtual reality, not in terms of science, but in terms of applied technology. So how to act, how to dramatize, how to write screenplay, how to use special effects, all of that. So there they have a memorial to Robin Williams, the auditorium where I spoke. The memorial to Robin Williams. Now Robin Williams was one of the world's biggest comedians. Most very famous comedian. Unfortunately, he committed suicide. Normally we think comedians are people who are happy. Isn't it? They make everyone laugh, so they should be happy. So after he committed suicide, I wrote an article titled After the Laughter. Yeah, on screen they will laugh, they will make others laugh. But what after the laughter? So actually, we understand that somebody may laugh, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they are happy. Because laughter is basically, it's more like emotional or intellectual tickling. You know, sometimes when you want to play, if you have some small child in your family, you may tickle the belly of the child. You go and tickle the belly, the child may start laughing. Now when the child laughs, is that laughter happiness? No. If the laughter from tickling were happiness, then the most important scientific invention in the search for happiness would be a perpetual tickling machine. All of us can have our perpetual tickling machines, and whenever you want to be happy, just tickle, tickle, tickle. No, that will not bring happiness. So actually, just as physical tickling cannot bring happiness, similarly comedy is fine, jokes are fine, but they themselves don't comprise happiness. And technology is also basically a sophisticated way of tickling ourselves. And emotional, through special effects, through entertainment, through movies, we're tickling ourselves. In fact, you could call technology is technology. You know, technology, that which tickles us. Again, nothing against technology. It's the purpose for which we use it. If technology is, we use technology to tickle ourselves and to fulfill our superficial desires, then we will mislead ourselves. But if we use technology with the spirituality, understanding the purpose of life, then that spirituality can help us find a life that is purposeful and joyful. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. So I spoke about how technology, spirituality, and the search for a meaningful life. First, I spoke about how in technology, science begins with the assumption that there is an order in nature. Newton's brilliance was that he found an order in nature. But where did nature get that order? Science can, by its discovery, find and its progress, find laws of nature. But laws explain the correlation between cause and effect. They don't explain everything. Laws of nature require nature to exist previously. And why those laws exist, that also requires explanation. So atheism requires too much faith, because atheism cannot explain where nature came from, where the laws came from. So theism actually explains things much more satisfactorily by saying that there is a starting with an intelligent being who has infused intelligent order in the world. So from nature we talked about activity. Why do bad things happen to good people? Why should they not happen? Why should there be a correlation of between good and bad? That order, again, atheism has no explanation for that. So we search for meaning, just as we search for a natural order in physical things, we also look for a moral order in the way things happen. So where did this order come from? And third point I talked about is about our own identity. All the cells in the brain change, but still our sense of identity and memory remains the same. It's like if I remove all the molecules, replace all the molecules on paper, but still the message remains the same. So our identity is not just material. The brain is like a computer, it's programmed from something outside of itself. That's what Wilder Penfield, he said. And then I talked about our desires. This is the African child desiring a pizza. Raises a question, where did that knowledge of pizza come from? Similarly, when everything around us is temporary, where does our desire to live forever and to love forever come from? It comes not from the outer material thing, it comes from the inner spiritual core. And our deepest desire is to connect with the eternal. When the eternal soul connects with the eternal whole, that brings eternal happiness. So we are not meant to reject desires, we are meant to select desires. But certain desires scream very loudly within us. And we impulsively tend to fulfill them. Technology makes it very easy for us to fulfill those desires. But if we let scripture guide us, spiritual knowledge guide us, then we'll be able to select desires wisely. Otherwise, we will end up tickling ourselves. And the more we keep doing what we like, the more we end up disliking ourselves. But when we wisely choose our deepest desires, then we will move towards a meaningful and joyful life. We need a strong sense of purpose to reject the lower desires. And that strong sense of purpose comes through spiritual knowledge. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions or comments? Yes, ma'am.
Whatever the brain is capturing, data is stored somewhere else also.
Yeah.
But we see that whenever someone has accident and they lose their memory also. So how it is?
Okay, good question. So I said that if the data is stored in the brain, then why is it that damage to the brain causes loss of memory? Memory is a profound mystery, how memory works. And even people who have amnesia, you know, when I was in New Jersey, I was at a mental health care center. And mental health care center is a polite way of what in Hindi we'll call pagal khana. Of course, the word pagal khana has a very, very negative connotation. People who need mental health care are not necessarily sick or mad, they're sick. But the point is, so there was a person with amnesia, and it's amazing. These people, they forget their name, they forget their identity, but they know language. They can speak fluently in English. There's this person, you know, he was an airplane pilot. And he knew how to fly a plane. In fact, they inferred his identity. He knew so much about a plane. There is some plane, a very advanced version of Boeing planes. There are only something like 23 pilots in the world who know that. And he knew that. And based on that, they found out his identity. So, he had lost all identity. But the point is that he was able to remember everything about how to operate a plane. But he lost his sense of identity. So, memory is a mystery. Now, what we understand is that the brain is one location for memory. There are short-term things which, for example, I observed over here. I remember, okay, this is a building with four doors, with two here, one there and one behind. This, unless this building is very important for me, I may not remember that for a long time. So there are some stimuli which just come in, they register briefly and they go away. Some don't register at all. Some register very deeply. So basically, some of our memory is stored in the brain. Some of it is stored in the mind. The mind is a subtle interface between the soul and the body. Now, okay, to give another example, if I use a computer. Computer, there's a hardware, there's software, and there's a user. So now most of my data will be in the hardware. If I delete it, if my computer crashes, my hard disk crashes, I lose the data. But if I have logged in using my Gmail ID, then my preferences, my search results, my bookmark sites, all these will be stored. And as soon as I log into another computer, all those preferences and all that data will come. So with respect to my data, some of it is stored in the computer, some of it is stored on the cloud somewhere. So like that, with respect to our memory, some of it is stored in the brain, some of it is stored in the mind. And that's how some people can remember their previous lives. And not some people may remember their previous lives, all most of us don't, but still all of us have certain tendencies. Some people are just so good at maths. I was in Columbus, Ohio, there was one student, Indian boy, 5.5 years old. He was the national robotic champion over there. 5.5 years old, he had made his own robot. Brilliant. And it's not that, sorry, not 5.5, 7.5. 5.5 is too early. But he is brilliant. So now, it is, what are those toys, logo or Lego? What is it called? You put the pieces together? Lego, no? So, the first thing he started doing since his child was just playing Lego toys. And he could just make shapes. So this, he could clearly see this skill was not just something which he had learned right now. He's carrying it on from a previous life. Not necessarily robotics per se, but just the idea of putting things together. Some people are brilliant at maths. Some people are great at chess, what we call as prodigies. So, there are things related with the physical body which are stored in the physical body and the memory is there and it's lost. But there are things which are more related to the subtle body. So that may be remembered. And many people who travel to different parts of the world, there are, I met one devotee who's traveled a lot and he says there are some places when he goes, he hears the language, I've heard this language. He went to Netherlands, he said, I've never been to Netherlands before, but when he went to Netherlands, he heard the language. Yes, he was there for 1 week and he picked up the language. Just, not just pick it up in terms of few words, just actually pick it up fluently. So now all these are not conclusive, they're indicative. Indicative of the point that actually there is something which is stored in the subtle body also, something stored in the brain. So yes, that which is, because the brain is also a tool for functioning. So at a physical level, I may know fluent English, but if my throat is damaged, I'll not be able to speak one word in English. Similarly, even if the memory is stored in the subtle body, if the brain gets damaged, then that tool is no longer functioning properly. And therefore, that part of the memory can become inaccessible. Can I answer your question? Yeah, yes. Okay. So, do we follow spirituality to fulfill our enjoying mentality? Even our desires, we say that we should be fulfilled. See, we are not meant to suffer. It's not that spiritual life means we have to give up, we have to suffer. The point is, there is intelligent enjoyment and there is unintelligent enjoyment. So, anandmayo abhyasa, the soul is by nature joyful. And enjoyment itself is not bad. It is the way we enjoy that determines what is good and what is bad. So, we are parts of the Supreme and He is joyful. And as His parts, we are also meant to be joyful. But there is a joy which connects by connection with the whole. And there is a joy which comes by disconnection from the whole. The joy which comes by disconnection from the whole is fleeting. It is like a drop of water. The joy which comes by connection with the whole is like an ocean. So we are meant to find joy in Krishna. We find joy in Krishna by loving Krishna, by serving Krishna, by harmonizing with Him. So we are meant to not give up the enjoyment, but find the best enjoyment, and not in a self-centered way. Bhakti is the joy which helps us to find joy. It helps us to share joy. If there's some delicious food item, I eat it, and somebody else can't eat it. That's finite. But if we learn to relish Krishna's message, we share Krishna's names, we share Krishna's message, then we share it with others. And the more we relish it, the more we share it with others. So it increases. If a devotee has great taste for Krishna Katha, the devotee says Krishna message, everybody becomes joyful with that. Okay? Yes. Yeah.
For certain time, we enjoy, can we get pleasure for certain time? So, like if we take, we eat something, some delicious food, we enjoy for certain time. May not be enjoyed. But what if this is material body? Material body cannot enjoy. Certain time, so who is that?
Okay. So, when we enjoy worldly objects, who is it that is enjoying? Is the body, is the soul? The soul enjoying by misidentification. The soul's consciousness gets projected into the body and through the body to other things. Just like when people watch a movie. At that time, who is enjoying? It is they who are enjoying, but it is their consciousness projected into the body. The extended projection goes on, if suddenly at the climax of a movie, suddenly power goes off. What happened? People start screaming, yelling because their enjoyment was started. So it is the enjoyment. Now we may say, ultimately it's just a moving illusion over there. That's fine. While the illusion is going on, it appears real. And who? And if the spectators, the audience were sleeping, they will not enjoy. They will enjoy sleep, but they will not enjoy the movie. So the thing is that consciousness has to be present. And consciousness has to be projected into that object. So to the extent our consciousness is projected to that object, to that extent, we enjoy. So the soul is spiritual, but the soul doesn't always enjoy spiritual happiness only. The soul may seek material happiness also, but that's where its consciousness is. Just like I may be sitting here, and I may have a very nice friend with whom I can chit-chat nicely. But suppose I am watching something on my phone. I can talk, instead of discussing and having a fulfilling discussion with somebody, I can just be looking at my phone and watching something, reading something, and trying to get some reciprocation over there, trying to get some enjoyment over there. So like that, where our consciousness is, that's where we will seek pleasure, and that's where we will experience trouble also. Okay. So even after we hear that we are not the body and soul, why can't we act on it? It's habit. It is, suppose the floor is inclined like this. Then, and say here I have got some valuable electronic equipment. I don't want it to get wet. Now if water falls on this, naturally the water will flow this way. Just my not wanting it to flow this way is not going to be enough. If I don't want the water to flow this way, do three things. Restriction, redirection, reconstruction. To create some band or some blockage by which the water will not flow in this way. The water keeps flowing, I use a mop, I use a brush and push it in another direction. And eventually for lasting solution, I have to reconstruct the floor so that it is inclined this way. The same way, whatever activities we have done in the past repeatedly, we have done, our mind has developed an inclination towards it. You can say our mental floor has become inclined in that way. So by default, our thoughts and desires will go in that direction. There's nothing to... It doesn't necessarily make us bad people. It doesn't make us people with poor willpower. It's not like that. It just... That's the way the mind functions. So we have to do these three things. Restriction. So, yeah. Okay, I'll come to that. So restriction means that we try to create some obstacle between us and that particular gratification. So then there is redirection. That means if the mind goes in a particular direction, you consciously get it back towards something that's right. The reconstruction is what primarily is spiritual. When by the repeated practice of bhakti, our mind becomes attached to Krishna. When the mind becomes attached to Krishna, then the mind will naturally flow towards Krishna. Mai asakta manaha. So, when the mind becomes attached to Krishna, then we will no longer have difficulty in sticking to our resolutions. Till then, it is going to be difficult. So, you don't have to become discouraged even if the water goes in this direction. As soon as we realize it's going in direction, push it back, push it back. So, we have to be patient. We can't expect overnight results. And in fact, the expectation that we should immediately be able to stick to our resolutions, that expectation itself is often arising from the ego. Because earlier I thought, I will be the enjoyer, I will enjoy the gratification of my senses. And afterward the same ego says, now I will enjoy the renunciation of the senses. Let's see, I have given up everything, you know. All of these people, they are so attached. I am so advanced. So no, gradually it will happen. Just be patient. Keep practicing bhakti no matter what happens. By the practice of bhakti, gradually things will change. Okay. If the mind is material, how can it trouble us? The mind is subtle matter, so it's like software. So, the software often has some default settings. So, I sometimes use a speech-to-text software, text-to-speech software. After I write an article, I get the computer to read it out. So, now, once I wrote an article, in which I wrote the soul is Sat Chit Anand. The computer edited, the soul is Saturday Chit Anand. It transforms Sat as, from its point of view, SAT is Saturday. So this is, it is the autocorrect which went incorrect. So like that, there are default settings within us. So the mind is like a software and it has its default settings. So this is the mind is troubling, that means what? The mind's default settings are popping up. The mind's default setting may be craving, it may be anger, it may be critical mentality, it may be pessimism, it may be self-doubt, whatever it is. So then, if that is my default setting, then I have to conscientiously note. Okay, this is my default setting. Mind goes off in that direction. I have to bring it back. Ito yato nischanti manaschanchalamastaram tatastato nyamyaitat atmanyayavishanyayat. Krishna says, wherever and whenever the mind wanders, bring it back to the continuum itself. Any other questions? We'll come back to you. Yeah?
If we develop devotees, after that, sometimes mind creates trouble in self-doubt.
Self-doubt about what?
Whether I can do, can I not do, can I do.
Okay. So if you have self-doubt, what do we do? We have to develop healthy sources of self-reflection around us. Healthy source of self-reflection means that suppose, I came for the program, I put tilak. Now before coming, I look in the mirror. The mirror is distorted. Then, no matter how straight I make the tilak will always appear distorted only. So in this case, the problem is not with the tilak, the problem is with the mirror. Similarly for us, we all look at ourselves through the eyes of others. What do others think about? And so we there are some sources of self-reflection, is looking at ourselves, which are healthy, and some sources of self-reflection are unhealthy. So maybe in our childhood we were compared with somebody. Why can't you be like this? Why can't you be like that? Why can't you be like your brother? Why can't you be like this neighbor? Why can't you be like that? Or even among devotees also, sometimes there can be unhealthy comparison. Some devotees may be very talented in one field, but others may be talented in some other field. So we have to find out what is the source of our self-doubt. Sometimes it's difficult to find that doubt, but more important is, what are the sources of self-confidence? Not self-confidence in an egoistic sense, but self-confidence in a spiritual sense. That I am a part of Krishna, and Krishna, no matter how I am, Krishna still loves me. Our greatest weakness is not lust, our greatest weakness is not anger, it is not greed. Our greatest weakness is our unwillingness to believe that Krishna loves us. Our greatest weakness is our unwillingness to believe that Krishna loves us. But Krishna loves us as we are. He certainly wants us to become better. But even now He is there in our hearts. He has not abandoned us. Sarvasya Chahum Vidisam Vishtu. And from here, He wants to guide us. He wants to help us to grow. So if we, through scripture, understand Krishna's love for us, even among devotee association, some devotees may be very critical. Some devotees may be more considerate and encouraging. So we have to see that I have to deal with my doubts. And those people who have too many doubts, some people, they are too overconfident. And then you have to bring them down to the earth. So don't fly, so I have to be realistic. Some people actually stay underground only. You have to get them out. Don't be so doubtful, do things. So depending on every devotee situation, our individual situation, we have to find out, you know, what is our need? Do we need encouragement or do we need cautioning? And then, based on our need, we have to find out where we can get that need from. Then we'll be able to overcome the self-doubts. Okay? Any other questions? Yes, please. My default, yeah. Okay. So aren't the default settings those just suitable? Why do we need to change them? There are different things. There are instincts and there are impulses. Instincts are desirable, even essential. Impulses are often undesirable and unhealthy. It's like, say, if I touch this mic and I find there's electric current over here, immediately my hand will move. It's not that I think about it, it's instinctive. So, there are, for our self-protection, the body has certain instincts within, programmed within it, which help us protect ourselves. So this is a programming that is healthy. That's a default setting which is not faulty, it is good. But along with that, there are impulses which come up. So when I feel hunger, I eat food. At hunger, sensation of hunger is good because that will make me eat. At the same time, sometimes when I get the urge to eat, it is not necessarily coming from the body. It's often coming from the mind. There's biological hunger and there is psychological hunger. You know, or we can call it pseudo hunger. Pseudo hunger is when we are hungry, basically we need food. But when there is psychological hunger, we want a specific kind of food. I cannot say, you know, I am hungry for pizza. Okay, I may say I have a desire for pizza, and it's not that it's wrong to eat pizza. The point I'm making is not against a particular food. I'm just saying that if I'm hungry, if it's a biological need, whatever food is there, it will satisfy. If it is a specific, selective, obsessive desire, then quite likely it is coming from the mind, not from the body. So when the impulses come up, quite often, when people are impulsive, eat little and eat more and keep eating more. So instincts are healthy. Impulses are often unhealthy. Because when we are eating, we keep eating, keep eating, keep eating. Impulse, little more, little more, little more. Body is saying enough. No, I want more. Then in this, so there are, it's not that all programming is bad. Some programming is good also. But some programming is bad. So that default programming which is faulty, that we need to correct. Does that answer your question? Is there something else in your mind? Okay. Good question. If God has made us, and He wanted us to be a particular way, if He wanted us to be pure, then why is our nature presently impure? Yes. It's, you know, Krishna made the mind. We made our mind. What does that mean? The mind is like a software, which is blank. The computer company gave us software. But based on how we use it, certain settings come in it. So we have been going through many lifetimes. And over many lifetimes, we have acquired certain tendencies. So that's one point of it. I can explain why different tendencies come within us. Another way to understand it is that this world is a place for testing, for purification. It's about selection. So I was in Melbourne, and then one student asked this question. If God wanted us to be good, why are the bad choices often so much more than the good choices? So many bad things to do, so few good things to do. That's how always it is in any multiple choice exam. So, four wrong choices, one right choice. Yes. Now, so the purpose of the wrong option in the multiple choice exam is not to mislead us or to fail us. The purpose is to test whether we have internalized what we have learned. Similarly, if we use our intelligence and then turn towards scripture, Emam buddhe param buddhva samstrityatmanamatma jai shatrum mahabahu kamarupam durasati. If we situate ourselves spiritually through the practice of bhakti, then we can go beyond, we can reject all our desires, we can select wisely. Okay? Is something more in mind? Okay. If somebody is from birth very shameless or very self-centered, concerned only about food, and neglects in good instruction they are given, what is that kind of person? We all have particular natures from our past, and if that is the nature a person has, then we have to guide them or help them where they are at. That means that if you consider a staircase, I will be on the 50th stair in the staircase. Somebody at the first stair. First step, 50th step, first step. So from the first step to move to the 50th step will take time. So if they are at that level, from that level they can take one step forward. It will be difficult for them to give up that self-centeredness entirely. But if they just understand, you know, it's not the best thing to do. It's not the way to act. So basically what we have to do is that they have some circle of interest. They have a certain conception of life. We have to find out within their conception of life, how can we put in something that will cause the expansion. So it may be, they just like to eat, Try to give them prasadam. If they just like to watch things, and try to give them something spiritual to watch. They have to be creative in that. Right? And it may not be very easy for some people to expand their consciousness a lot. But even a little expansion is also possible. So just try to find out, if this is the circle of interest, how can I bring Krishna into their circle of interest? Not just Krishna directly, but any aspect of Krishna. So get that in and start the expansion from there. Okay? Yes, ma'am. Yeah? Okay. Yeah, are the current scientific models, so the universal standard theory, standard universal theory, or other theories, quantum physics, are they compatible, congruent with Shastra, or are they different? Shastra uses knowledge from a different perspective. The purpose of scripture is not to give us material knowledge. Material knowledge may be there in scripture, but that is not its purpose. It's like when Parikshit Maharaj is about to die, at that time, the purpose of scripture is not to give him exhaustive knowledge about the universe. So knowledge is given, but the purpose is to help him to fix the mind in Krishna. So if we position science and scripture as competitors, by positioning science and scripture as competitors, we devalue scripture. Scripture is giving us the knowledge which science can't give. The knowledge of who I am. What is the ultimate purpose of life? And now, as in science or in scripture also, there is material knowledge which is there. Now, whether that material knowledge is applicable or relevant today or not, that will vary, because the universe itself has different ways of looking at it. So there may be that science, for example, in physics itself, there is quantum physics and there is relativity. And these two are significantly contradictory. In fact, Stephen Hawking said that they're just not reconciled. In fact, he said that, I'm happy to announce that humanity's quest for knowledge will never end. So, the Guardian wrote that even he has given up. The point which they're making is that the universe is not reducible to any one model. Shastra offers us some understanding of the universe, and Shastra also offers us different models. There is a Sankhya model of the universe, there is a Mimamsa model of the universe, there is a Vaisheshika model of the universe. The cosmology also, there are different kinds of cosmologies described, even in scripture. So we don't have to get caught in technicalities. We understand that if you consider this as the total body of scriptural knowledge, some knowledge, some small sector in that will agree with science, some small sector will disagree with science. But the essence of scriptural knowledge, that is beyond science. So our focus is on that. That is what is scripture's special gift to us. The scripture is not there to tell us how to fly a plane, or how to measure the speed of the earth, or whatever. That can be there in the scripture, but that is not the purpose of scripture. So we have to keep the purpose very clear in our mind. Then we can avoid a lot of unnecessary tension and conflict. When there was this conflict between science and religion, Galileo said that science tells us how the heavens go, scriptures tell us how to go to the heavens. How the heavens go means how the celestial objects move. The science tells us that. But how to go to the higher planets, That scripture tells us that. And when you go to the heavens, it's not just a physical locomotion, it's an elevation of consciousness. So again, any kind of statements like this are often oversimplifications. The important point is that we understand that both science and scripture have their domains. And the domain is primarily determined by their purpose. There will be some areas where there is congruency, there is some area where there is conflict, and these have to be specifically resolved. But the most important thing is, we understand the purpose of everything. Science gives us certain knowledge by which we can operate the world around us. We can function in the world. But the ultimate purpose of the functioning, that knowledge is given through scripture. Okay? Okay. So, and last question, is anyone here? Okay. Who has not asked till now any questions? Yeah. So atheists say that with death everything is finished, and as long as we live, until that time we have this longing for love. So apart from reincarnation, is there any other explanation? No, reincarnation is not an explanation. What we are talking about here is reincarnation can be an explanation for certain things, such as why certain people remember past lives, or you can look at it as a philosophical explanation for what is the purpose of life. But when we are looking at our own desires itself, okay, we may say that as long as we live, we have desires. It's fine. But why do we have desires? And why do we have a desire that is non-circumstantial? That is the key thing. It's out of place. It's, say, if I have never been to Somalia, to Africa anywhere, I have never met a Somalian person. And if I start speaking Swahili, how do you know Swahili? Question will actually come, isn't it? So we are not talking about desire per se. We are talking about a specific kind of desire. And the desire to live forever, to resist death. When the theory of evolution is based on the idea of survival of the fittest, the only the fittest will survive. But that doesn't explain the question, why do we want to survive? And not just survive, but survive forever. No living being wants to die. Even people who commit suicide, it's not that they want to die. It's that they feel that the condition of living is a greater state of suffering than the condition of dying. They don't know what dying is. They think dying is non-existence. But even at that time, it is basically the longing for joy, which is expressed perversely as the longing to minimize suffering. So, the basic desire for eternal enduring existence, the basic desire for joyful existence, that itself is something which has no explanation. Where does consciousness itself come from? It has no explanation. The only explanation is that it has to come from something non-material. So, yes, at the level of the body, if the body is damaged or destroyed, we may not express our desires. But even when the body is functioning right now, where are my desires coming from? If consciousness is simply the certain stimulation of electrochemical signals in the brain, circuitry, then electricity going through the brain causes desire, but electricity going through this mic or my computer doesn't cause any desires. Why is that? Consciousness is something which is fundamentally different. That is what requires an explanation. Did I answer your question? Okay, one last question.
What is the nature of consciousness? what is consciousness? What is the
What is the nature of consciousness? It explains in scripture in full detail. It depends on what we mean by full detail. Consciousness refers basically to the capacity for awareness. And that is of different categories. Yatha prakashayati ekah krishnam lokamivam pravi kshetram kshetri yatha krishnam prakashayati bharata yatha sarvagatam saukshnad akasham nopalipyate sarvatra avastito dehi tathatma nopalipyate. In 13.33 and 34, Krishna used two metaphors to explain how the consciousness functions. Just like the sky is present everywhere, the sky pervades everything. But it is different from it. That means when a plane is moving through the sky, it is moving through the sky, but the sky doesn't get broken because of that. The sky just keeps existing. So like that, consciousness pervades everything. And then second example is the sun illuminates the whole universe. Similarly, consciousness illuminates the body. Pervasion is basically, so the first metaphor is for pervasion, the second metaphor is for activation. The sun activates life on the earth, photosynthesis and everything else happens. So similarly, the soul is different from the body and consciousness is the energy of the soul. So there is chit and there is chitta. Chit is the consciousness of the whole, it is a faculty. Sat chit ananda chit. Chitta is the embodied consciousness. So based on the kind of body we get, so the soul goes into, its consciousness gets affected accordingly. So if I am in a human body, the soul will speak like a human. The soul is in a dog's body, the soul will speak like a dog. Not speak necessarily, bark like a dog. The whole point is that there is consciousness which exists in its self-existential transcendental glory, where there is pure perception and there is pure joy through the perception. In the pure stage, the consciousness perceives Krishna and delights in Krishna. But in the conditioned stage, the consciousness does not pursue Krishna because the consciousness is contaminated. Then what it perceives and what it desires, all that is determined by the conditioning. So we want to move from the impure consciousness towards the pure consciousness. Sankhya is a subject of analysis of the world. Some of the six systems of knowledge, therein this is consciousness described much more in detail. The third canto, chapters 27 to 30 in the Bhagavatam, are where you can study more about consciousness. Thank you very much. La Prabhupada ki Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki Gaur Premanandhi.